Hello and welcome. My name is Brendan Stubblefield from Texas Brewing Incorporated. We're here today to help you brew your first homebrew batch. It's real simple, real easy. If you guys can boil water at home, you can make your own homebrew beer. There's going to be a few things that you need to be able to accomplish this, and we have those available on our website at txbrewing.com. We have our most popular kit. This is our deluxe equipment kit. We're going to show you all the stuff that's inside there, how to use it. You'll also need an ingredient kit that will be able to make 5 gallons of beer. And then also you'll need at least a 5 gallon stainless steel pot. If you don't have one at home, we have them available on our website. They're very affordable. We have them manufactured for ourselves, so we're able to cut out the middleman and pass that savings along to you. So homebrew beer is the best beer in the world. And there's a lot of reasons why. First and foremost, I think the most important part about homebrew beer is that you get to tailor make recipes to the taste that you like. The second thing is I'm not really brewing for a profit, so I'm able to do some things that commercial breweries can't really do because it's not viable financially. And third thing is I have a little bit of time on my side, so I can afford to wait for my beer to mature, unlike some commercial breweries that are able to have to push their beer out or right away before it may be actually at their peak. So there's a few things that we're gonna go over today. We're gonna look at our ingredient kit that we're gonna be brewing today is the Sweet Texas Crude. It's very easy to drink. And if you guys have ever had left-hand milk stout, you know you've had something similar to this. And we're going to show you all the steps it takes to get there. If you guys purchased a new pot, it's always a good idea to take 2 or 3 tablespoons of PBW and actually use it to clean your new pot, because there's lots of contaminants that may be on your pots from the manufacturing process. You don't want to use any kind of detergent or soaps, because these can also leave off flavors in your beer. So make sure to get something that is actually made for brewing. I wouldn't use anything abrasive as well. I'm just going to use a few paper towels that are not abrasive. Go ahead and clean this up. Make sure that it's good and clean. Make sure there's not any kind of residual oils or anything left over from the manufacturing process. Now, when you use PBW, it's always really good idea to make sure that it's really thoroughly rinsed well. You can also use PBW and let it soak overnight. That's a good idea as well. Today we're in a little bit of a pinch for time, so we're going to actually just scrub it a little bit and then we're going to rinse it out real well. All right, I think that's going to about get it, so we're good to go. Okay guys, now that we got our pot all good and clean, the next step is we got to talk about water. Water is very important to brewing, and the reason being it's 90 to 95% of your beer. So if you don't like the way your water tastes at home, make sure you don't use it, because if you do, you're going to taste the same things in your beer that you don't like in your water. So if you do like your water at home, the one thing that I will say is make sure that you remove the chlorine from it. Okay, there's a few different ways that you can do that. One of the ways you can do that is through a carbon filter. That is probably the most popular way to do it, or probably the best way to do it. You can also use Camden tablets or potassium metabisulfate to help remove the chlorine as well. Or you can use bottled water. If you use bottled water, that's fine, as long as you use a spring drinking water. Make sure you don't use distilled water, okay? Also, we're gonna put about 3.5 gallons in here. That's a little over half of what we've got here in a volume. That's a 5 gallon pot. If you can put a little more in there, that's okay. That's fine too. Just make sure that, and remember that the more you add to the pot, the more you got a chance of this thing boiling over when it comes up to a boil later. All right, so we're gonna put some water in the pot, get started. All right, here we are. We're gonna fill our pot up with water. Might be a better idea if you actually did it over the sink instead of on the stove, but with the way we've got this set up, we're going to go ahead and pour it in. All right. Got a little, probably closer to 4 gallons in there, or 3.5, 4 gallons, and that's what we're going to run with. So the next thing we got to do is we actually got to get our grains out of our kit, and we're going to show you what all is in this kit, and then we're going to put it together. Okay guys, now that we've got our water in our pot, we're going to bring up our temperature up to about 152 to 154. You're also going to be supplied a lab thermometer in your equipment kit, so you'll be able to test your water temperature. Now, once we get our water temperature up to that, we're going to put our steeping grains in. Not all kits have steeping grains, but the one we're going to use today does, so we're going to show you how to do that. Okay, now that we have our pot here going, what we're going to do is we're going to get our muslin bag out. You'll be supplied in one of these in your ingredient kit. They're just like a kind of a cheesecloth, and this is what we're going to put our grains in, and then we're going to steep this just like a tea. And you can see here that it can expand quite a bit, so you'll be able to get all of the grains in there. Okay, so we're going to get our specialty grains out. This is where you get all of the different fancy flavors for are all the really in-depth flavors that you're going to have in your beers. So example, this particular beer has roasted barley, and has chocolate malt, it has a little bit of coffee malt, and a Brees Victory, which is kind of like a toasted malt, so it'll give it a little toasty flavor as well. It's probably not a bad idea to get somebody to help you with this, just because it can truly be kind of messy. So depending on your beer kit, you may have a bunch of steeping grains, and then other kits may not have very little or none, just depending on the recipe. This recipe here has quite a bit of steeping grain. But this is what makes all your beer have all these different complexity. If you notice, I did this over my box here, just so you don't get a bunch of grain dust all over the floor. Okay, so now what we're waiting for is we're actually waiting for the water to come up to 152 degrees. And then we're gonna stick this in our pot and let it steep for about 30 minutes. Okay guys, also you'll be supplied a lab thermometer in your kit, in your equipment kit. So what we're shooting for is about 152 to 154 degrees. It's really important that you get it in with that range, okay? Also, you want to remember too that you never want to get your steeping grains over 170 degrees. This is really important, because if you do, you might extract tannins are what you get in a red wine that really dries out on your tongue, so you don't really want that in beer. It's really undesirable. But if for some reason you do happen to get it over 170 degrees, just cool it off as fast as you can and don't freak out. It might be perfectly fine. So, okay guys, now it looks like we've got our water up to about 154, 156. It's really, like we talked about earlier, the most important part is we don't want to get over 170. It's really a good place to start though, is about 152 to 154. If you get up to 160, that's okay too. We're just trying to get all of these different sugars and flavors from these different specialty grains. But the most important part, like I said, is make sure that you don't get it over 170. Okay, so we actually turned our fire off. We're gonna get our grain bag here. And like I said, I put a lot of dust in the box, that's no big deal. Now we're gonna submerge this grain bag here in our steeping pot. And it's okay to kind of dunk it a little bit, just like you would in a tea bag. And you're going to notice that right away you're going to get some different color and stuff of that nature if you have some a darker colored beer. And of course the stout, of course, is quite dark. So I like to tie the muslin bag on the side of the pot. I think it's just easier later on, and you can retrieve it very easily when we want to take it out of here. Okay, so what we're going to do now is I'm going to put the lid on. This is the only time that you really use a lid during brewing. And what this does is this helps us maintain our heat a little better. Now you want to check during this 30 minutes of time while you're steeping your grains, you want to check periodically and make sure that you're not getting too cool, because you still want to bring that temperature up if it gets a little cooler. So all you have to do is turn the temperature up on your pot. But we're going to move on to the next step here in about 30 minutes or so, once we get 30 minutes worth of steeping time, and we'll get to rolling. Okay guys, now that we've actually let our grain steep for about 30 minutes or so, we're going to remove the grain bag. And the most important part I can tell you is when you let this pull this grain bag out, just make sure that you don't squeeze the grain bag, because if you do, that can extract tannins. We talked a little bit about that earlier about extracting tannins by getting your grain too hot. Well, you can do the same thing by squeezing the grain bag. So just let it drain out and then toss the bag away. And then what we're going to do is we're going to bring our wort up to a boil. Okay. Basically, that's what wort is, actually unfermented beer. That's another terminology. So anyway, we're going to get busy with that. And we can remove the lid here. And like I said, just let it drain out. You really don't have to let it, you know, get the majority of it out of there. But like I said, don't make sure you don't squeeze it and squeeze all the water out of it. It's a good idea to have a bowl or something next to you so the grain will drain out in there, or you can just throw it in the trash can. Okay, that's probably pretty good. As you can see, that can make quite a mess if you don't have something to put that in. Okay, so now we're going to bring up our wort up to a boil, and then we're going to move on to the next step. Okay guys, now you can see we have our wort up to a boil. Now it's time to add the malt extract. Most important part about this step is that you need to make sure that you remove it from your heat source. The reason being is because if you for some reason happen to the extract sinks all the way to the bottom and scorches, well, it can actually cause your beer to be a little darker than you want it to, and it can also cause it to be a little sweeter. So what we're going to do now is we're going to turn the fire off, and we're going to move it over here from the heat. This particular kit has liquid malt extract. It also comes in dry. I think it's a little easier to use liquid. That's what I prefer. It's a little less expensive as well. So this particular kit only has 5 pounds. Some kits will have more, some will have less. But this is where you're getting the majority of your sugar that your yeast is going to consume and make alcohol and CO2. So what we're going to do now is we're going to add this to that to the pot. As you can see, this is a lot like molasses or maple syrup. Actually tastes really good if you want to put it on some ice cream or your pancakes. It tastes well too. So it is sticky and messy. The good news is it cleans up with a little bit of hot water. So okay, so now what we're going to do is we're going to add this to the wort here. Okay, you want to stir it in real well, because the bottom of that pot is really still really hot, so I want to make sure that we don't scorch it. Really helps too if you have another person to be able to help you out with this. Makes it a little bit easier to do. Okay. Okay, so we've about got all of it done in here. We still have a little bit more. You don't have to get all of it out of there. I mean, it's a good idea to get as much as you can But you don't have to get every little last bit of sugar out of here. You can put some extra hot water in here to get the last little bit out of there. I usually don't bother with it too much. That's not going to add or take away from your beer too much. So rather than making a bigger mess, I just usually get what I can get out of there. Okay, now the next step is move it back over to the fire. And we're going to bring it back up to a boil. Then according to whatever your beer is, you're going to add some hops at different times during the boil. This is where you're going to get your bitterness, your flavor, as well as some of your aromas as well. And we'll talk a little bit about that in future episodes. All right, we'll see you after the next step. Okay guys, we've got our pot up just about ready to boil here. And what we're going to do is we're going to check our brew day schedule. It's going to tell us when we need to add our hops during the boil. This is a countdown from 60 to 0. A lot of recipes, for the most part, have a bittering hop as soon as it becomes up to a boil. Now, the most important part is to make sure once you come up to a boil to watch your pot like a hawk. The reason being is that it's going to want to boil over on you. So what you want to do is make sure that when it comes up to a boil, make sure you get through that initial trying to boil over phase or foam up on you, and then you want to add your hop addition and start your countdown. Okay, what this process is called is actually what's called hot break. So there's a bunch of proteins coming to the top, and then what's going to happen is they're eventually going to coagulate and fall back out of the pot. This particular beer here that we have, it doesn't actually have a bittering hop until 45 minutes. A lot of times you'll see some recipes that will actually have later hop additions instead of at 60 minutes. This may have to do with bitterness, smoother bitterness. This particular beer is probably so we could get a little smoother bitterness to go with this sweet stout. Okay guys, we've gotten to our first bittering hop, which is going to be at 45 minutes. Like I said, most of them are going to be closer to 60 minutes or right after the initial boil starts. This particular recipe says 45 minutes, so that means 15 minutes after the boil begins. Okay, so the other thing that's important when you're adding hops, you might have to watch it. I pour mine just directly in there. Some people use hop socks. I just use mine and put them directly in. The thing that's going to be you need to watch, though, is a lot of times your pot is going to want to boil over again. When you add hops, but this particular one did just fine, so we shouldn't have to worry about it too much. So we have one more addition that's added at the last 15 minutes. According to whatever beer you're doing, they're all going to be different, so make sure you pay close attention to your recipe. So once we get this, we add our next hop addition, we're going to cool this down. We're going to actually use an ice bath to cool it down. One of the better ways to use it to do it is also a wort chiller. Most people don't have those available. When they first start out, they use an ice bath to cool it down. The other thing that we're going to use too is I actually cooled some water. We have some bottled water that I have in the refrigerator, and I'm going to add that back to the beer to actually try to cool it down too. It's really important that we cool this beer down as fast as possible once we're done. There's a lot of different reasons, but the main reason is bacteria likes warmer temperature. We're not brewing in a sterile environment, so we want to make sure that we cool it down as quickly as possible, get the yeast started in here, so if there is happen to be any bacteria, it'll make sure to take care of it. The yeast will take care of it. Okay, it's actually the alcohol and CO2, but anyway. Okay guys, we're about down to our last step on this particular recipe, and it's actually adding some maltodextrin. What maltodextrin does is it adds a little body or mouthfeel to your beer. So if it's a heavier beer style, you might actually have this in your kit. Not every kit has this, but there are going to be a few that do. Make sure the most important part when you're doing your recipe, make sure you read your instructions and then read them a second time, because every beer is a little bit different. Although the procedure is the same, there may be different hop additions, different sugars, additions and such. Okay, so with that, what we're going to do is we're actually going to add our maltodextrin, and our lactose. This particular beer has lactose in it. What lactose is it's a milk sugar, of course, and that's what gives it the little sweetness to your beer. So we're going to add those now. Okay, we're adding the maltodextrin. We add this in the last 5 minutes of this particular beer because we don't necessarily need to be cooked. It just needs to add, just to make sure that it's sterilized. And that's one of the things we're going to talk about next. As soon as we get this beer done and we start chilling it, we're going to talk about sanitation. Because it is one of the most important parts of brewing, and we always save that for last, so it'll be fresh on your mind. Okay, we've got the maltodextrin stirred in. Now we're going to stir the lactose in. If you taste lactose, it's not really, really overly sweet. It's not like sugar sweet. So it's not going to add a whole lot of really super sweet flavors to your beer. Okay guys, we're going to let this boil for about another 5 more minutes, and then we're going to start our chilling process. All right, see you at the next step. Okay guys, now that we've done all of our hop additions, we're going to finish out our boil, and then we're going to cool it down. Cooling is very important for beer, and there's a lot of different reasons, but the main reason is that bacteria likes to work at 100 or so degrees temperature, okay? So what we want to do is we want to get it down as close as we can to 75 to 80 degrees. The cooler the better, of course, so we can get our yeast started in here. And what that does is that starts to produce alcohol and CO2, so if there happens to be any kind of bacteria, it'll surely take care of it at that point, okay? Other thing is that your clarity, it's not really an effect on your temperature or on your quality of your beer or the flavor, but it can have a haziness to your beer if you don't cool it down quickly. Okay, so what we've done is we're actually brewing about 4 gallons of beer. So what we're going to do is we're going to add a couple of gallons of water back to this to actually cool it down. But before that, we're actually going to use an ice bath to actually try to cool this particular amount of wort before we add the cold water back to it. And the reason being is because if I just go in here and add a couple gallons to get to 5 gallons, to cool it off, we're going to have 5 gallons of 120 degree wort. So it's really important for you to go ahead and cool this off first and then add your cold water to get you down to around 75 degrees, which is about optimum pitching temperature. Okay, so there's other ways of actually chilling as well. One of that ways is actually something called a wort chiller. Our immersion chiller, that's what most people start out with. It's not necessary to brew your first batch, but that's something that most people add over time. What it does is it actually, you put it inside of the wort, run it through the water runs through it, and this works as a little small heat exchanger, and it actually removes the heat. You can use it on a water hose, or we have adapters as well that you can use to put on your sink. Okay guys, well, after this, we're going to get back to our chilling, and we'll show you how that's done. Thanks. Okay, guys, now that we have our pot in the sink, we're going to start up our ice bath and start to cool this beer down. You can also use a cooler for this if you'd rather use an igloo cooler or something of that nature. That works as well. So what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and add some water to it, fill it up. Ice water actually will help it. Although we're melting a lot of it, you have more surface area when you have ice water. So Now the next thing we're going to talk about is sanitation and how important it is. So what we're going to do now is we're actually going to start sanitizing our equipment. Nothing has to be really sanitized as far as your pot's concerned, but when it comes to once your beer starts to cool down, it's very, very important that everything touches your beer at that point has to be sanitized. Now, there is a difference between sanitization and cleaning. Just keep this in mind. You can't sanitize dirt or organic material. So it's very important to remove any kind of dirt. That's what we use the PBW for. In sanitation, we use something called Star Sand. This is a non-rinse sanitizer. And what we're going to do is we're going to mix some of that up here in a few seconds in our primary fermenter. Primary fermenter is included in your equipment kit, and we'll talk about that just here in a few minutes. Okay guys, while we're letting our wort chill down to our pitching temperature, I'm going to talk a little bit about our equipment. Most of it we're going to use later on. The one thing that we're going to use today is we're actually going to use the primary fermenter that's included in your kit. This is the one without the hole in the bottom. The one with the hole in, or actually the bottom of the side here, you can see here, is actually used for our bottling. And we'll see that later on in our next episode about bottling and secondary fermentation. Okay, so you'll see here it says 5 gallons of wort. We're going to add our wort once it cools down to about 110, 120 degrees into here. Then we're going to add our cold water at that point to get 5 gallons. Now this is just an approximation. On the bucket, it's not exactly 100% accurate just due to manufacturing processes, but it's a pretty good ballpark. So what we're going to do next is we're going to get this all sanitized up, because anything and everything that touches your wort, once it cools down, has to go through sanitizer. And how are we going to sanitize? We're going to use something called Star Sand. This is what's included in your kit. You use 1 ounce per 5 gallons. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and fill up my fermenter all the way up to 5 gallons, and then I'm going to add 1 ounce of this. We're going to let that have about a 30 second contact time, and then we're going to pour it out, and then we're going to fill it back up with our beer. Now it's really important. A lot of people really get upset about the foam. Star Sand is extremely foamy. That's part of the cleaning and sanitation action. Okay, so don't fear the foam. Don't rinse it out, because if you rinse it out, you've just undone what you just did. So make sure that you don't sweat it too much about the foam. Okay, so you'll see it here in just a second. We may have a little bit of foam left over. It's usually especially bad in your carboy, but like I said, don't sweat it. The yeast will actually consume it as a nutrient. All right, so let's get started. We're going to use this bucket here. We're also going to have a lid and an airlock. So let's get this stuff sanitized, and then we're going to add our beer to it. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to start filling up our bucket with Star Sand or water, and then we're going to add about 1 ounce of Star Sand. Since your kit comes with a Star Sand that doesn't have a pre-measuring tool, most people have a shot glass, so you can use a shot glass to get an estimation. Most shot glasses are 1.5 ounces, so you only get about 3/4 full of a shot glass, and then that should be plenty. Now, on the Star Sand, when it dries, you want to make sure that you keep the stuff wet. If it dries out, you need to reapply it, because it's no longer sanitary. Also, remember, if you do have some Star Sand available, or you're doing some other type of, if you're racking or something like that, you can always soak all of your other equipment in this as well. So we're going to put our lid and our airlock, as well as our thermometer, and a new tool that we're going to use here in a few minutes, our hydrometer. Okay, this tool here is actually our hydrometer, and what it's used for is actually to test the sugar in solution. Now, it's really expensive to have a tool that actually tests alcohol, so what we're going to do is we're going to test the sugar beforehand and the sugar afterwards, and that what that'll allow us to do is that'll tell us how much alcohol we've made. And that's going to go here in our sanitizer as well. Okay, so now what we're doing is we're testing our temperature to see exactly where we're at. Hopefully we're getting pretty cool. Now the thermometer, just remember, is fresh out of the star sand. Now we've actually got this pretty cool already. It's already at about 85 degrees. So what we're going to be able to do is we'll be able to cool it the rest of the way down with our cold water that we have in the refrigerator. All right, okay, now that we have our bucket sanitized, we're going to add our beer that's in our pot in to our bucket. Now, this is a very good idea at this point. You want to oxygenate your wort. It's very important for yeast to be able to reproduce. So what I do without an oxygenation system is just basically splashing the wort into the fermenter. Now you might want to do this outside. You can potentially make a big mess, but for our purposes here, we're just going to pour in the bucket. And you can see too that we have star sand right in there. No big deal. Have a little bit of foam, that's fine. Okay, I got a little bit of hot particles. I don't necessarily need to get all of that in there. If you get some in there, no big deal. I'll just leave most of that behind and pour that down the sink. Okay, now what we're going to do now at this point is to add our cold water up to the 5 gallon mark. And like I said earlier, we had gotten the wort down already all the way down to 85 degrees. Now you can get it down to probably about 100 degrees before you add the cold water, and that'll probably take you down to about your pitch temperature. Now what I did is I did save a little bit of star sand so I could put my hydrometer, my airlock, as well as my thermometer. So we're going to test, make sure our wort temperature is not too hot before we add our yeast. Okay, so all right, that 2 gallons puts us right at the 5 gallon mark. So we're going to be able to test our temperature now and make sure that we're not too hot. Okay, so we're sitting right at 70 degrees, which is actually pretty cold. So that's not a bad thing. You just don't want to get it too terribly cold, but 70 degrees will work just fine. Now, the next thing is we're going to take a hydrometer reading. This is going to tell us how much sugar is in solution. On your kit, you're going to have an original gravity and a final gravity. Now, these are estimations. Sometimes they will be close, sometimes they'll be way off. But more often than not, they're going to be really close to your numbers. So what we're gonna do is, you can use this a couple different ways. We got this straight out of the sanitizer, so we're gonna put it right into the wort and see approximately what we're looking at. Now with this much foam, it's pretty hard to tell exactly where our wort's at, so our gravity reading is at, so we need to maybe move this around a little bit. Okay. Looks like we're about at 1042. If I'm not mistaken, that's pretty close to where we're supposed to be on our original gravity. We're actually supposed to be at 1046, but that's pretty close. So we may be a couple tenths of percent off, but that's not going to have an effect on the overall beer. You also have to remember too that this hydrometer is calibrated at 60 degrees, so it will make a difference if it's a little warmer. All right, so we're going to record that down as 1042, and we're going to add our yeast at this point. Okay guys, what we have here is our SO4. This is our dry English ale yeast. This is a really good yeast. We recommend for beginners especially to use dry yeast. There's a lot of advantages to dry yeast over liquid yeast. The one thing that you have as far as drawback as far as dry yeast is there's not as big a selection. But for beginning sake, I would highly recommend using dry yeast. And later on, you might be interested in starting doing starters in order to do liquid yeast. Because at Texas Brewing, we highly recommend that you do a starter before you use liquid yeast, on all liquid yeast. I pulled these scissors right out of the sanitizer, so we don't have to worry about contaminating our yeast. Now, there's a lot of debate on whether to rehydrate or not to rehydrate. We have found at Texas Brewing that the benefits don't outweigh the consequences by rehydrating. So what we recommend to do is actually pitch it directly on top of the wort, just like you see there. Now, it's very, very important. We talked about this earlier, that you make sure that your wort's not too hot, because you will kill your yeast. Okay, so now that we have our lid sanitized, our bucket sanitized, and we have our yeast pitched, what we're going to do is we're going to put our lid on. And I've got sanitizer all over my hands. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to aerate the wort, okay? It's really important to have oxygen in your beer. And the reason being is because in order for a yeast to reproduce, they have to have oxygen available. So while we're going to do that is we're going to shake the bucket for 2 solid minutes. And you can do this just by putting your hand over the thumb hole, because I've got sanitizer all over my hands. And I'm going to shake this for a good 2 solid minutes. Okay, now once we're done shaking this, we're actually going to put either some sanitizer or some, the best thing to do is actually put vodka or a cheap vodka in your airlock. Okay, so after shaking that for 2 minutes, you're gonna put your airlock. Now it's important to find a good cool place in your house. And we're gonna talk more about that here in just a second. Well, there you have it. You just brewed your first beer. We hope you enjoyed us showing the different steps that it takes to make your first beer. It's real simple, right? Okay, so now that we have our beer in our fermenter, the next thing we have to do is we need to make sure to find a nice temperature controlled environment, preferably in your house somewhere. Don't stick it out in your garage where the temperature is going to go up and down. The idea is to keep it below 75 degrees. So what we're going to do is we're going to let this sit for about a week, and then we're going to come back and do a second episode and teach you how to move it into a secondary and also to bottle it. Until then, make sure to check out texasbrewing.com. That's TXbrewing.com, and for all your brewing needs.